I am going to be at the Philadelphia Punchline Sunday at 7 o'clock with Dr. Katz, Dr. Jonathan Katz, and Bonnie McFarlane. And we're doing a live episode of Dr. Katz at the Philadelphia Punchline to raise money for Artwell, healing people through art, theartwell.org, Philadelphia Punchline, this Sunday, 7 o'clock, Dr. Katz Live, me, Bonnie McFarlane, and a whole bunch of other people. What a great show for a great cause.
Listening to the David Feldman radio program, You Sad Pathetic Hump.
On Thursday, the GOP-controlled House passed a new health care bill that will leave 26 million more Americans without health insurance. You know, if ISIS wants to kill Americans, all they have to do is donate money to the Republican Party. It's 3 a.m. Friday, May 5th, 2017. I'm David Feldman. We have a live show today from QED in New York City, so let's get right to it. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, DavidFeldmanShow.com. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. It doesn't cost you more money. And don't forget, for as little as $5 a month, you can gain access to our premium content. Live shows are back. We have a live show today. Yes, my longtime listeners will remember fondly those great live shows we used to do back at the Fake Gallery in Los Angeles, Paul Kozlowski's Art Gallery on Melrose. We used to do those shows with Jim Earle, Eddie Pepitone, and everybody used to drop by and play with us and do sketches. Well, we're bringing back the live shows to New York City. We did one last Saturday at QED in Astoria, Queens. I want to thank Christian Finnegan, the great comedian who owns QED in Astoria, his amazing wife, Cambry, and Chris Gersback. He also is working over at QED these days. Thank you so much for helping me out. Hey, if you're visiting New York City, hop on the N train and head on out to QED in Astoria, Queens to see some of the freshest, most original comedians anywhere on the planet. For more information, go to QEDAstoria.com. Here we go, our live show from QED with Sean Donnelly from Conan and Letterman, comedian Angela Cobb, and our most despised guest ever on the David Feldman Show from New York City Crime Report, Pat Dixon. Good evening and welcome to a live episode of the David Feldman Show. We're coming to you live from QED in Astoria, Queens. What a great place, Astoria. How many of you here, by applause, are from Astoria? Thank you so much for going out of your way to come out and see me. I really appreciate it. I'm so touched. I really want to get the sounds and flavors of Astoria tonight, because we had Jeremiah Tower on the show, the great chef who invented California cuisine. He revolutionized food in America because he taught us to appreciate what's right in front of us. And that's what I'm going to do tonight. We're in Astoria, and we're going to celebrate Astoria. The sights, the sounds, the coughs, the tuberculosis, the people who are dying to see me. It's okay. I love your cough. It's a beautiful cough. Any Greek people here tonight? Big Greek population. Did you know that, ladies and gentlemen? Did you know? I'm sorry? Could you cough a little louder? I didn't hear you. What is your name?
Joan
Moretti just said that Astoria, Queens has the second biggest Greek population next to Athens. In fact, Astoria has so many Greeks, its real name is Astoria. Astoria. Tori, well, it's great to be here. How many of... Well, Donald Trump is celebrating 100 days. Well, the Democrats call it 100 days because we still believe the Earth revolves around the sun. 100 days, one long night. Bill O'Reilly is gone. Don't worry about Bill O'Reilly. Donald Trump just appointed him to be Secretary of a Woman's Interior. Okay, what do you say we start the show? Well, when I announced that I was coming out to Astoria to do the David Feldman Show,
yes,
people went crazy. They could not believe that a big star like David Feldman was coming to Astoria.
We had to close off roads.
Please welcome the mayor of Astoria.
Oh, thank you. It's great to be here. It's an honor to have David Feldman in this fine neighborhood.
Thank you, Your Honor. You know, we had Jeremiah Tower on, the chef who invented California American cuisine, farm to table. He has taught me and my listeners that we must celebrate the environment. Wherever we are, we must taste the wind, smell the scent, taste the herbs, what's in front of us. And that's what we're here tonight in Astoria to accomplish. We want to sample Astoria. We want to smell it. We want to feel it.
Yes.
And want to welcome the mayor of Astoria. How long have you been the mayor of Astoria?
About 5 years now.
Congratulations. Yes.
Thank you.
And I understand you're a Democrat?
Yes.
And you're about to give me the key to the city of Astoria.
Well, I wouldn't necessarily call it the key.
I was told it was a key.
Well, it's kind of...
Is there a key? I was told usually when I bring this show to a big city, the mayor usually offers me a key, and I cut a ribbon, and it's David Feldman Day, and there's a framed plaque that I can bring home to my office. No, I was expecting a key, and
there's
David
not so much
Feldman,
a key. No.
Swag?
You can call it swag if you want. So, we welcome our guests by kissing them.
I was told it was a key.
I'd kiss you, is what we would do.
Is there a key? I was told it was a key.
I will kiss you, though.
Well, I don't understand. Usually it's like David Feldman Day, a proclamation, I cut a ribbon, I get...
I'm going to kiss you. So we're going to kiss on the lips.
Am I getting a key? I was told there's a key.
Well, we don't have a budget for a physical key.
I was told it was a key.
Kisses.
This is a tradition here in Astoria.
Yes, yes.
So you're the mayor of Astoria, Chris Gersbach. You're telling me that you welcome celebrities
by kissing them.
Where?
On the lips.
I was told it was a key.
Are you ready to do?
Well, when in Greece. Okay. You're going to kiss me?
Yes.
Okay. Right. I was told it was a key. All right, let's try kissing now. Ready? Oh, I just want to be honest with you, Mayor. This is the first time I've ever kissed a man.
Okay.
In Astoria, Queens.
Okay, right. Okay, that was fantastic. Yeah. Oh, yes.
Okay.
Fantastic.
All right.
Okay. Welcome to Astoria.
Thank you. Everything okay?
I gotta get something off my chest. I'm not the mayor of Astoria. There is no mayor of Astoria. It's a neighborhood. It's a part of the borough of Queens, and Queens is a part of New York City. Bill de Blasio is the mayor of New York City. I'm just a guy.
Oh. All right. Not getting a key?
Enjoy your stay, though. And welcome. Welcome to Astoria. David Feldman. Welcome. I'm going to go.
You're not going to kiss me goodbye?
No.
All right. Not even a peck on the cheek?
Have a great show.
Chris Gersbach. Oh. Well, next time I come here, we're going to make sure that Mayor Bill de Blasio sodomizes me because I feel deceived. Our first guest, this is very exciting. He is a local favorite, and you've seen him on Letterman, Conan. He hosts Defend Your Movie, a good friend of this show's. Please welcome Sean Donnelly. Hi, Sean.
I just want to say I am actually the real mayor of Astoria.
Okay. All right. Nice to see you. Wow. I am one lucky man tonight.
You're the belle of the ball.
Not getting a key? Sean Donnelly, I've been trying to get you on the show for a long time.
I know.
Thank you.
I love your show.
Thank you.
I love your politics. Because I agree with everything that you say. So yeah. I love... That's what people want, right? They want to agree with what you're listening to on the radio and TV. Right?
Yes. Can you turn the reverb up, Alex? I want this to be as much of an echo chamber as we can possibly. Because we have Bill Dixon coming up later.
Pat Dixon.
I made him change his name. Actually, there was a Bill Dixon who used to write for my show.
Oh, really?
Yeah. A very funny guy. Pat Dixon is coming up. The most despised guest I've ever had on this show.
Do you get letters?
Letters. People cancel their subscriptions. They loathe him. And my first inclination is, good, we have to have him on the show more often.
Well, you guys couldn't be more opposite, I feel like.
Yeah.
Because you guys just talk about politics when he comes on?
I try not to.
Oh, okay, yeah. But it's very hard to do, probably.
It is. I find that there's a disconnect with certain people. Pat Dixon is one of them. I'm always happy to see him. I think he's brilliant. He's funny. But when it comes to politics, his IQ drops to 2. And I don't understand it. I think there's some kind of like physiological, psychological defect.
Yeah, I think it's a going against the grain just to be a shit stirrer kind of thing. Mm-hmm. To me. That's what it is.
Yeah.
I don't know if he even believes half the stuff that he probably thinks. And I like Pat too. I know Pat for a while.
Go on with that.
Yeah.
Sure, I think there's something true about that.
I honestly believe that's why. I think there's people that something happens in their brains that they go against logic and they go, everybody's thinking this one thing and logic serves this one thing. I'm going to go against it just to be different.
Just to be different.
Yes. To incite problems, to incite
right.
a different point of view. But I think they're doing it under the guise of, well, I have a different point of view. Like, it's just to single yourself out, to make yourself more noticeable, but you're literally doing the opposite of logic. That's mm-hmm. what's happening. With this Trump thing, that's why I don't get it. Like, that's why I don't get the whole Trump thing, because it's not, it supersedes politics to me. It's not, there are people who voted for the guy who agreed that he wasn't qualified for the job.
Right.
That doesn't even, that's bonkers to me. So that's what I think. That's probably what he's doing.
Why do you think people would vote for a president who wasn't qualified?
I think it's nationalistic, racial bullshit.
Why would you say, well, you know what? This pilot is an idiot.
Right.
But I want to prove a point.
I'm going to go on this
Let's
plane.
Let's get on this plane.
Yeah. Yakov Smirnov is my pilot. But I'm going to still go on this plane.
Yeah.
I think what the news tries to make you believe is that it's all these people who felt marginalized for so long. They thought they were being put aside for years and years. But I don't believe that. Mm-hmm. I think the reason that he won, not to, you know, I feel like this is very brave to say in the middle of New York City, but like the reason that he won is because you had a lot of people that didn't want to vote for a woman. And then you have a lot of people that, it's absolutely true. And if you have
Do you believe that?
Oh, yeah, because
hang on. We noticed a woman applauded that.
I think so.
Let's ask the people who are evolved. Sorry. I just wanted to push the women away. That's what I do.
You're just channeling Pat Dixon earlier in
yes.
the show. Yeah.
But do you really think that, like, Ann Coulter, if she were running, wouldn't women vote for her who wouldn't vote for Hillary? Is it really sexism? Don't you think that there are Republican women who would vote?
I think there's a little bit of everything. I think mm-hmm. it's not just that, but I think that when it came to her, I think it was very easy for these people to not get on board with Hillary because of her being a woman. I think that you had a guy who literally wasn't qualified for the job and literally just came on an interview saying that he thought it would be easier and he misses his old life.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he said. Now we're trained to listen to all that and just disregard it because that's just him.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually, there's times where I feel bad for the guy because I don't think he wanted to win. I think he did it because Obama made fun of him at the White House Correspondents' Dinner. I believe that. I honestly believe because he got shit on at the White House Correspondents' Dinner. I really think that's why he ran for president. Because now that we know him better, doesn't that make sense? Like, doesn't that make sense that he would react to that? Like, now we know his Twitter and we all know all that, that he saw somebody roasting him that he didn't think should be doing it and he just went right away. That's it! You made my mind up for me. I'm doing it! I'm becoming president! And then he did it. He absolutely did it.
Don't you think if you met him,
you would love him?
Right.
Yes.
Because he hates Mexicans, right? That's why we would love him. Right?
Exactly.
Personally, I don't think he's charming, but
anybody
who's
Mexicans.
Willing to talk that way about Mexicans is okay with me, right? I will forgive bad table manners, but he hates women, and he grabs them without asking for permission.
Who is this charmer?
So, no, but I mean, the same thing goes with George W. Bush, right? I mean, if you met him,
I'd want to hang out with him.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. And that's what everybody says about these guys. I met somebody who was a writer on The Daily Show. I forget the guy's name. And he said, that's what he does. That's what how he brings all these people in. All these guys that he has all over the news that are defending him, it's because he's known them for years and he just hangs out with them on a personal level. So he's like, no, he's a good guy. It's like, good guy doesn't mean that he can be in charge of nuclear weapons. Do you know what I'm saying? Good guy. It's like, think about your friends. You want them to be president? You know what I'm saying? Like, I love my friends. I don't want any of those fucking morons to be president. I'll hang out with them till I die, but I don't want them to be in charge of healthcare. Uh-huh. You know what I mean? Like, that's where it boils down to. And because I think there is a dumbing down that's happened over the years. Put it this way. You ever see a letter that was written in the time of Abraham Lincoln? People had better handwriting back then. Do you know what I mean? You ever watch one of those letters and the way they, or a letter from the Civil War home to a farm kid from the Civil War home to his girlfriend? He's using beyond SAT words. He's using my dearest, you know, he's using the longest words right. You can use. And think about it now, how people talk now, and that's why people relate to him, because he's like, oh, he talks like I talk. Here, that's the other thing. I shouldn't be president either. Like, when I watch Trump, I'm like, it's like me being president. It's not like I'm defending myself. Like, no, he shouldn't be doing it. I could probably pull it off, but he definitely, I shouldn't be president either. So that's what it boils down to, I think. I really do.
Are you scared? Or are you tired? I'm tired. I'm too tired to be scared.
I'm too tired. Have you gotten to the point where you ignore the news? That's why I've noticed myself full on ignore, like, not, I won't watch the news for 3 days. And you miss so much when you do that. You ever not watch the news for a couple of days? Oh my God, you go back to it, you're like, oh, I'm dead tomorrow. That's what's happening. We're dead. The other thing is this. The fake news thing is not true, because there's a lot of news reporting that happens that is absolutely 100% true. But there is an element of truth to it, because what it is, when you have show business people taking over the news business, they are literally trying to make CNN look like ESPN, and it's trying to pull you in visually as well as, like, sensationally, like where it's like, right. Hey, nuclear war, North Korea, whatever it is. So when I am scared, I don't know if it's that I'm scared because there's actual some real threat, or I'm scared because I watched MSNBC for 15 hours straight and I'm just losing my fucking mind. You know what I mean? Like, I don't... Like, if you watch MSNBC, you would think we're getting into war tomorrow and a nuclear weapon is on its way here. Mm-hmm. But then what contradicts it is when they go, oh yeah, they tried to do a missile and it failed. Mm-hmm. And we probably hacked the missile.
They didn't have to hack the missile. They just had somebody from the Trump administration press the button.
So my thing with that is, like, I'm like, I also, you do have to put the news to blame. Like, the fact that the next day after he won, that those networks didn't turn around and go, listen, we failed in reporting things accurately to you, and we did not see this coming, and we had poll after poll after poll that told us the opposite, and we should have done our due diligence more and really understood what the country was, and we didn't. The fact there wasn't an apology by any of those networks means that it's all together. It's all one big machine to make you nervous.
To make you nervous, and to keep the fight going.
There has
to be an argument.
Yes.
There's no news.
Yes.
Unless there's an argument, it can't be a discussion.
It can't be a discussion. That's why you have CNN. That's why you have Wolf Blitzer, one of those guys. And they bring up 9 screens of people talking for 9. They don't even have 9 people on a podcast. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can't. Right. Why do you have 9 people talking about the news in little squares, and that's supposed to be reported? It's not reported.
It's not reported.
It's not reported. It's not. And you kind of have to. You wonder what's going to happen to it. That's what I'm wondering. Is, like, because I think the only thing. What's the last stronghold of objective journalism is what? Newspapers?
Yeah, the New York Times,
the Washington Post. But even that, you gets called out for being...
Letters to Hustler is...
Right, that's...
They cover all sides. Back and front.
Yeah, if you let cable news take over the news business, then it's just going to... You're not going to be able to decide what's for real and what's not.
What do you think of... Oh, go ahead.
Oh, the other thing I wanted to say, I don't know if you know, but did you hear about this? Do you ever hear about... Now... Do you know, I saw an article about this, and then I saw a video piece about it, that they've gotten video technology to the point where they can just take a video of you and make it look like you're saying whatever they is that they want to do. And all they need is like 15 seconds of your voice, or like you saying certain words, and a video of you talking, and they can make your lips and yourself look like a legitimate news clip of you saying whatever it is they want you to say.
You sound like the lawyer who's defending me in that thing that happened. I can't talk about it, but I'm innocent. So thank you for bringing that up.
Of course.
We won't need Bill O'Reilly's anymore.
No.
They can just have robots.
They can have robots. They can have robots. Well, not even just the robots, like made up people. It's literally you can take Hillary Clinton's video.
Well, she already is a robot. So. Ma'am, is that okay?
That's quite okay.
Is it okay that I called Hillary a robot?
Okay. She is a robot. Hillary's like every HR lady from your office. That's maybe another reason people didn't vote for her. That's how she comes off. She does. You feel like you're getting demerits every time she talks.
Right. She kind of ran human resources at the White House.
She did.
Yeah,
she did.
A woman would come in and say, the president just groped me, and now we're going to destroy you, man, for reporting that. I mean, she really enabled a horrible...
Oh, yes, she did.
That is the problem. I did vote for Hillary, and I wanted her in 2008 instead of Obama, right? I wanted Hillary, right? Because I wanted her before Obama, because I'd much rather have a woman than a black guy in the Oval Office.
Right? Right. You go right.
Right, right. Women, on the evolutionary chart, we put women above black people.
It's science.
It's phrenology. It's phrenology.
It's phrenology.
It's skull shapes, and I don't want to get into it, but I studied
David
phrenology.
David, you wrote the bell curve, didn't you?
I wrote the bell curve. I studied phrenology at Heidelberg State.
You had one of those things that goes on top of the head and measures it. Remember that?
No, I wanted Hillary, but of all the women in all the elections, she had to walk into this
joint.
Right. I mean,
exactly.
It could have been Elizabeth Warren.
Yeah.
I would have been much happier with Elizabeth Warren.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Just because she's prettier.
It was a weird... when he won, it was a weird... If you did not agree with... It was a weird feeling.
Oh, I was there.
But the night that he won?
I was at the Javits Center.
Oh, were you really?
Yeah, I was working, and we went there to cover the victory party. It was just a given.
Oh, my God.
It was a given that she was going to win. And I was already beginning to figure out how to hate her, because that's my job. And I was, you know, calling my daughters and teasing them, and, you know,
without realizing what was going to happen.
Yeah, I called my daughters up and I said, you know, you'll visit me in the re-education camp, right? And can I keep half my shaft? You know, and they didn't find it funny. They did not find it funny, much like this audience. But and then as the night wore on, it got
darker and darker.
Really dark. And depressing. And
were people just shuffling out? What was happening?
There was... I took photographs of women who were there. I took pictures of Andrea Mitchell, a female reporter. We were around. They were all really sad.
Yeah.
And it reminded me of Michelle's speech when she went after Trump and talked about what women are constantly... putting up with.
Yeah.
And it was like this collective, oh, this again.
Right. Oh, right.
Oh, this again.
And we're getting screwed again.
We're getting screwed again. So it was a great night for me, but...
then you went to a strip club, didn't you?
Then we went to a strip club. And
I'm trying to do it. I just
can't. You know, put some Harriet Tubmans down the G-string. And, it was great. It just went over to the Trump... I think it was the Hilton. He was at the Hilton. Yeah. And I took pictures of those people. And they are...
Incredulous, probably.
They're all drunk. they smell. They're hateful. They are almost as bad as Pat Dixon. Who is the most hated... guest
on my show. Other reason that I think that she didn't win, and I really believe this, is because she wanted it too bad. I think that's also because she tried hard. I think us not giving it to her was everybody collectively, all these people going, nerd, what, do you want to be president since you were a kid? Nerd. I think that was actually part of it. I really do.
She may have been overqualified.
I think Obama was overqualified.
Yeah.
I think Obama was too smart to be a president. And I think Hillary, yes, she was overqualified.
What do you think about him taking $400,000 from Wall Street to speak? From Cantor Fitzgerald.
Cantor Fitzgerald, really?
Yeah.
I think that's kind of... You know what? It makes sense to me. I'll tell you why. Because he was never... He's not Bernie. He's a... What do they call
it? Corporatist.
Yeah, he's not a... He was always a Democrat. He wasn't a centrist. He had his problems with that stuff. So
yeah.
I think he's not... He wasn't a financial warrior. He was... He stayed in wars. He kept us in wars. He put us other places. So I don't think... He wasn't a giant hippie, so that's whatever.
Yeah,
that
agree.
That makes sense.
I agree, but usually when you're no longer president, you have a come to Jesus moment where you kind of
show
your true colors.
Yeah.
Maybe he's showing his true colors.
I think as far as like PR goes, they're going to have him donated or something. I can't imagine him coming out of this, especially what's going on now, and then not being like, hey, you got to give the money to
first responders, because Cantor Fitzgerald.
Right. Yeah. They were wiped out.
They were wiped out.
Kid I knew in high school.
I'm sorry?
A kid from high school died. He worked for Cantor Fitzgerald September 11th.
In high school, he was working for.
No. I mean, I knew him from high school, and he worked for Cantor Fitzgerald in 2001. In the building. And they held the whole company got wiped out. Mm. Yeah. That's why it's first responders. That's what we're trying to say, right?
Yeah. Where were you on 9/11?
I was on 65th Street, and I didn't realize. I thought it was just. I worked at this place called the Albert Ellis Institute, which was this guy, Albert Ellis. And when he died, the Times, he was a psychotherapist, and the Times compared him second to Freud.
Wow.
Which is kind of crazy. He was an old.
In terms of coke addicts?
Exactly. In terms of groping patients, that's what he did. No. He was a crazy old guy. I worked in his bookstore. He had a bookstore in the basement. I would send out books.
Oh, wait, hang on. You know what? I wasn't focused. I apologize. I have a joke.
Yeah?
And I'm pretending to listen to you. So ask me. Ask me where I was.
Okay.
On 9/11, and then I want to hear about
that. Okay, cool. Where were you on
9/11? First, let me piss everybody off. Go ahead. Ask me where I was on 9/11.
Where were you on 9/11?
I was at Logan Airport going, oh my God, I forgot to give Muhammad Atta the other box cutter.
You did it. You pissed everybody off.
I pissed everybody off. These are people who came to see me, who listened to the podcast. I love them. You see why I'm getting a divorce? Do you see why nobody talks to me?
I love it. I love
you love it, but if you get too close to me, I'll push you away. These are people who came out of their way to see a taping of this show.
The only one you're close with now is the mayor of Astoria.
But I want to go back to...
Where I was? So I worked at the Albert Ellis Institute. I sold books for him.
Albert Ellis Institute.
Institute, yeah. It's a brownstone. It's still there on the 65th Street in Madison.
But right, so he was okay at 9/11.
He was okay, yeah, right. Because we were all the way up there.
And he's dead.
He's dead now. But he died, I think he died like 5 years ago, a few years ago.
And was he a Freudian?
No, he invented rationally emotive behavioral therapy.
Rationally
emotive behavioral therapy, which basically turned into just yelling at your patients. That's what he did. That's pretty much what it is. And but he was the one that's like, you can find it head on. And he was like, I used to hear him yelling from the basement at his patients.
So it's kind of like Primal Scream, but it's the doctor screaming, not the patient.
Exactly. And he didn't want to talk to you unless you were like his intellectual equal or like in his industry. So I used to purposely try to talk to him just so I'd hear what he'd say. Like one time I fixed a doorstop on his door and I go, look, Dr. Ellis, I fixed a doorstop. And he looks at me and goes, you're a genius.
What's the guy's name?
Albert Ellis. If you look him up,
Ellis,
E-L-L-I-S.
Wait. Didn't he do like the stages? Trust versus mistrust?
He might have. It might be part of RET, Rationally Emotive Therapy. Because he's famous. He's well known.
I know the name Ellis.
Yeah. Oh, you do know the name Ellis.
Yeah. They used to bring crazy people to America and put them on Ellis Island. It was an insane asylum. And they would process the people from Ellis Island.
That's true, yeah.
And if you were really insane,
yeah,
then they'd let you into New York City.
Right. And he was there.
Yeah,
Ellis Island. He would yell at them for an hour, and then you would get to go.
Anybody who was rational and wanted to get an education, they would send them back to Europe. Yeah. That was Ellis Island. And that's how we ended up with Trump.
First name is Albert, last name Ellis.
Yeah, I know the name.
You do?
Yeah.
If you study psychology in school, he's in, like, the textbooks.
I've never studied psychology, but psychology has studied me.
I'm sure.
Have you ever gone for help?
Oh, sure. I've been going for the past 4 years.
I'd be dead if it weren't for...
For therapy? Oh,
yeah.
I love it.
I've been in therapy since I was 18 years old. And I still can't get my mother to sleep with me. What? They kind of hint. They're like divorce attorneys. They want to string it out. I know there's a secret to bedding my mother in the Oedipal complex.
It's very complex. That's actually a pretty good joke, and nobody heard it.
I don't know.
You said it's got to be a secret.
It's very complex.
I know, it's pretty complex.
Uh-huh.
It's an Oedipus complex. So fuck you guys.
What kind of therapy do you do?
I don't know what type it would be. I just go to, it's just psychotherapy. Just it's just pretty straightforward. It's the type where she doesn't tell me anything about her, and I just talk the entire time. I feel like I hear about a lot of therapists that get way too involved in their patients' lives. I know nothing about my therapist.
Now, are you Irish Catholic?
I am. Yeah. So this is a big deal. Well, so,
what is the difference?
You know, Irish people, it's a big deal.
What? Really, they don't like therapy.
No.
So they're okay with untreated mental illness. You say. We don't want to, I don't traffic in stereotypes, but you are Irish.
I am Irish. Irish American.
Right, Irish and American. And we don't, I'm not going to traffic in ethnic stereotypes, but in your drunken opinion. What in your potato-infused brain? What do you think?
I really have to think about it.
No, seriously, do they look down on therapy?
It's you're closed off.
Freud say you cannot treat the Irish?
Yeah, I think it was Freud. Yeah, it was Freud. Nobody is impenetrable to therapy except for the Irish. That's what he said. Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. Why do you think Irish wakes are so fun? They don't want to admit what's going on.
Why do I love Irish women?
Because you like being shitted on?
No, they're so sweet.
They're very sweet, but there's Irish people are the kings of ignoring the elephant in the room. They're the kings of... Irish people in general are just the masters of of not dealing with whatever issue you have.
And I'm a Jew, right?
Right. So issues is your main thing.
There's an elephant. Let's look at that elephant over there.
And then Irish people. Okay, so the elephant's there. Jews are like, well, look at that elephant. I'm really worried the elephant's going to stand
right.
Me. Irish people are like, check out his nose. That's
Ooh,
what it is.
My nose or the elephant's? What did you mean by that?
No, the idea is make a joke so we don't have to deal with what actually is happening.
If you are intermarrying
between
me and the elephant. So it makes for a good combination, they say. Irish and Jews, it's a good combo.
Yeah, that's a big one, and Irish and Puerto Ricans. It is. And we're white, we can't say the word Puerto Rican.
But Puerto Ricans are
very highly
hot-blooded.
And Irish,
they keep it in. But this is a stereotype, right?
Stereotype.
Right? The Irish Absolutely. Keep it in until they punch you.
Absolutely. Too. Yeah. If you're an Irish person, you probably punch three walls in your life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like I've punched holes in walls.
Me too.
Yeah.
And I punched a hole in a wall this morning, and boy, was the man on the other side of that glory hole angry with me. I'll tell you, don't punch a wall when you're at Show World. This is one of my mottos as you get into your 50s,
right?
Is I will no longer subsidize. This is my motto. I will no longer subsidize dishonesty, incompetence, and untreated mental illness. When people misbehave around me,
right.
My rejoinder is, get out of my face. I do not subsidize or tolerate incompetence, dishonesty, or untreated mental illness.
That's the healthy way to do
it. So you went for...
therapy.
For mental illness. What about your dishonesty and incompetence? Are you ever going to deal with that? Because I'm getting sick of you passing yourself as Sean Donnelly when you're not. You're Irving Einstein. Tell everybody who you are.
I'm Albert Ellis.
Yeah. When did you...
Like 4 years, 4 years ago? I started... you mean therapy? Yeah, 4 years ago.
We have to wrap it up?
Yeah.
Let's talk about QED.
Okay.
And why people need to support QED in Astoria.
I think because any kind of comedy going on in Queens, I think you need to support. I live in Queens now. It's a great place. Astoria is a great neighborhood. I met the mayor tonight. That was exciting. And also because I know Cambry very well, and she's awesome, and it's a cool spot because it's a fun neighborhood thing to do. Like people, there's daytime stuff, there's nighttime stuff. It's introducing stand-up comedy to a place that really didn't have much before.
And this is a gymnasium.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, Christian Finnegan... one of the greatest stand-up comics of all time. This is a place where you can experiment. Like the first thing I thought when we want to do a live podcast, I said, well, we'll do it at QED.
Yeah.
QEDAstoria.com. You take the N train.
Yes.
All the way out. Ditmar stop.
Yep.
And you come to QED.
And you come down and check it out. They got a bunch of cool snacks and drinks and stuff for sale. Come on down.
Defend your movie.
Defend your movie. It's on iTunes and Google Play and Stitcher, and it's on Laughable. You ever see the Laughable app?
No.
It's great. You just type in, you download the app, you type in somebody's name, it'll give you a rundown of all the podcasts they've done. So if you like a particular guest on podcasts, you can have them all in one spot.
You're doing stand-up tonight?
I am. I'll be at the Comedy Cellar tonight.
And how was the Fire Festival? I understand you performed at the Fire Festival.
The Fire Festival was good. I had three cheese sandwiches, and I took a raft back to Miami.
What was it? Before
did you guys hear about the Fire Festival?
Yeah, well, tell us what the Fire Festival is. And then...
The Fire Festival is a festival that Ja Rule, remember the rapper Ja Rule?
Yeah.
Where would I be without my baby? That guy, he put on a festival, a music festival with some tech millionaire, and all these people paid like thousands of dollars to go, and all these celebrities were promoting it on Instagram, like Kendall Jenner and all these people. And then people got there, and it was literally Gilligan's Island when they got there. It was like there was no infrastructure. There was tents that had no beds in them. People were like frantically stealing beds from other tents to get one in their own tent.
Wow.
And like they canceled the festival on the Thursday that people got there. There's all these news reports coming out that all these bands canceled. So they found out that all these A-listers knew that it was going to be like this. So they were told beforehand, don't come to the island. Hmm. So it was this whole big mess. If you Google Fire Festival, you'll find out a lot of stuff. Oh, is it
it's
the Post?
In the New York Post?
That was the most New York sentence I've ever heard in my life.
Read the New York Post.
In that lady's voice. Read the New York Post.
Sean Donnelly, everybody. Thank you, Sean. Defend your movie. Thank you, buddy. You were great. Thank you so much. One more time for Sean Donnelly. And that was fantastic. Our first guest. Who can follow Sean Donnelly? Other than every comic in New York City. And a little later on, Pat Dixon, the most detested human being in the history of the David Feldman Show, will be here. But one of the most beloved guests we've had on this show is a very funny comic who hosts a show called My First Time. It's the third week of every month here at QED. It's where comics get up and talk about losing their virginity. And she's a great comic. Please welcome Angela Cobb. Hello, Angela Cobb.
By the way, can I say one thing? I think it's hysterical that we're supposed to say that Pat Dixon is one of the hatest people because of his politics, because there's so many other reasons to hate Pat Dixon. There's so many. I think voting for Trump is one of his more redeeming qualities. I just thought that was cute. That we're
it's okay to piss on Pat Dixon because he is undefeated in roast battles.
Right.
Did you know that about him?
Yes, I did actually know that about him.
And
at New York Comedy Club, right?
At the New York Comedy Club, and he kicked my ass.
I was disappointed about that. I wanted you to...
Were you there?
No, but I wanted
you... Well, if you had showed up...
Oh, I would have... You would have won?
Well, I...
What am I, like somebody who didn't vote for Hillary? What is this?
Where were you raised?
Well, I'm from Long Island originally, Lynbrook. But then we moved upstate when I was a kid, so I just kept the accent out of like pure rebellion. I was like, I don't want to sound like these fucking rednecks. So, so I kept it.
Where in upstate?
Like near Oneonta, like that area.
Oneonta?
Yeah.
Where's that?
Not too far from Cooperstown. And,
oh, I know Cooperstown.
Yeah, it's not too far from Cooperstown. I went to college in Oneonta, too. Yeah, so Oneonta's not bad. Think about upstate as like any area where there's a lot of small towns. You like Oneonta has two colleges and everybody's fine, and then you go like 15 minutes outside of it and it's like, oh dear, like, you know, they don't know. Like, you and I would both be considered exotic there.
Right.
Like, they'd be like, a Jew, a Catholic, what?
Oneonta is an old Indian word meaning Oneonta. Is that true? And by Indian I mean Delhi, you know.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Oneonta, and it's near Cooperstown. Was baseball invented in Cooperstown?
Isn't the big thing like Abner Doubleday invented baseball,
yes.
And it was like in or I took a Native American literature class, and Native Americans had an early form of baseball that they played that was much before Abner Doubleday. So it's kind of, I think, a myth that it was invented in Cooperstown.
There are a lot of myths.
Yeah,
that would be a hit and a myth about baseball, right? A hit and a myth. Yeah, there are, like, I, we had a, the author of Don't Know Much About History.
Okay.
On the show. And I asked him, did we give syphilis to the Indians, or did the Indians give syphilis to us?
Oh, wow.
And they don't know. I was told when I was protesting Columbus Day, because it's an, you know...
It's so stupid, yeah.
Well, but just anything to piss off Italians, right?
No, well, see, I, as an Italian, see, my whole thing is like... See, to me, being an Italian who's big into Columbus Day, that's like being an Italian who has, like... Sinatra in up in your room. You're an American Italian. You're not a real Italian. You know what
right.
I mean? Like you're very Americanized. Because I feel like real Italians don't give a shit about Columbus Day. Like I remember once my Italian grandma was talking about Columbus ever. Like not giving a shit.
Well, and he was working for Spain.
Yeah, exactly. It was, so it, who cares? It,
you know, the Spanish
that pisses me off,
paid
yeah.
him.
Yeah.
To kill the Indians.
Right.
Because
exactly.
it was a hit.
Exactly. Exactly.
I read Columbus's diaries, and he would walk up to the Indians.
Right.
And he'd say, nice teepee you got here. It'd be a shame if anything happened to it. What do you got for me? And they gave him tobacco and a potato and syphilis. You do a show where comedians describe losing their
yes.
virginity.
Yes, here at QED, third Wednesday of the month. Yeah.
What is the most bizarre story you've heard about losing your virginity?
You know what's funny? I want to say my own is pretty bizarre. Like, I lost my virginity during Hurricane Sandy, so it's kind of hard to top that. I mean, there's been people who have, like, I had one guy, he...
No, let's go back to Hurricane Sandy.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. So, I mean, that's actually why I did the show, because I had an interesting experience, and I talk about it a lot in my act, so I was like, well, what could I do here that might be interesting?
It was during Hurricane Sandy.
Yeah.
That was 2012.
Yes.
Because that's when Christie hugged Obama.
Right.
So
right.
we all did a lot of crazy things.
Yes, we did. We did. It was not to Chris Christie. Don't worry.
You lost your virginity.
Yes.
During or after?
No, like during. It was, yeah.
The wind was blowing.
I mean, we were in an apartment. So, you know what I love? When I tell this joke, I feel like people are envisioning, like, debris and houses and bodies, like, floating by. And I'm just like, fucking this guy. Like, no, you know, everything was fine where he was. It was actually in Astoria, so Astoria is good.
You lost your virginity in Astoria?
In Astoria, yeah.
Really?
Yeah. But I lived in Brooklyn at the time, and everything was okay with my roommates in Brooklyn. Everything was okay where we were. So I didn't, there was no reason to even feel bad about what was going on, because it wasn't like my roommates in Brooklyn were like being flooded.
Were you flooded?
yeah. Oh, yeah. No, it was good.
Do you mind if I ask you
about this? Yeah, okay. I talk about it all the time.
So as I recall, 2012 would be 4.5 years ago.
Yeah.
And you're coming up on your 30th birthday.
Yes.
Not having voted for Trump, I'm pretty sure that would have made you 25 when you lost your virginity. Because I didn't vote for Trump. I can figure that out. You were 25.
Yes.
If you were my daughter, I would be okay with that. That would be...
Right.
I would say, okay, that's good. Good girl. That's it. I mean, I would prefer it if you waited... till I was dead. But you're not my daughter.
Right, no.
I have daughters, and if they want to end a conversation with me, they will talk about their boyfriends.
Right, I see what you're saying.
And I always say, you know what? I want grandchildren. I just don't want to hear how the sausage is made.
But like my dad is okay with it, like on stage. Like he's heard my jokes about Hurricane Sandy and he thinks they're hysterical, but like the minute I start talking about it, like he's like, nope, this is
nope.
Your mother.
Don't tell me how the sausage is made or what it tasted like. I just want to. So it was Hurricane Sandy.
Mm-hmm.
Do you still see him?
No, that's what's interesting. It's like we've had a very like complicated relationship. Like I feel like we saw each other a little bit after Hurricane Sandy, then he kind of broke it off, and then we tried to stay friends, and it got complicated, and then we had saw each other again for a little while, a couple of years ago, and now, like, we just had another fight, so it's a very, he's Italian, too, so it's
right.
a very, like, he's a
hey,
comic.
There's an earthquake in Haiti, let's have sex.
Yeah, right, exactly, you know what I mean, so it's actually kind of, like, it's both good and painful for me at the same time, the dynamic with a person.
Can men and women have sex in America? Because
okay.
I think this is a screwed up country. I think we're a transactional nation where people confuse love with power fear and domination. I think we are a really screwed up, loveless culture where we're all pretending we're dating and we're all pretending we're married. We're all pretending we're in love. And it's all people trying to control one another because we're a sick, diseased, failing country. That's our show. Thank you very much. I had Meryl Marco on the show, great writer. She was saying that it's very hard for men and women to have uncomplicated sex.
Okay, well, see...
And I want to know if that's true. Can men and women have sex, and then it's, thank you very much, here's your money. What did you say it was going to cost? Can men and women have sex?
I think they can. Honestly, the only person I've ever had uncomplicated sex with is the person I lost my virginity to because, like, we both knew each other. Like, I love this person. Like, I know this person. You know what I mean? Other people, I've been able to just have sex. Oh, that was fun, and then we don't... You know what I'm saying? So I think it's possible.
Can a man and a woman be friends?
Mm-hmm.
That's the question. Can a man and a woman be friends... And then they're like traveling together and they go, you know what? Let's just have sex because it's convenient. Can a man take a woman to Cooperstown? Just to see where baseball was invented or not invented. And can they go, you know, we're in Cooperstown. We're at the Hall of Fame. Why don't you let me get to first base? Can it be uncomplicated?
I think it can be. Yeah.
It can be so he says, all right, I just want to give you a big, wet Mayor of Astoria kiss.
I think it can be uncomplicated, yeah. But also you have to consider, like, are they mutually attracted to each other?
Even if they're not mutually attracted.
Right, see, that's an issue already, because then it's like, you know.
Okay.
So you got to have mutual...
So they can't have... I maintain that it is impossible for men and women to have... anything that involves sex or approaching sex without somebody being disappointed. The man, the woman, the sheep, the goat, whoever. Somebody's going to end up feeling bad.
See, again, like the only complicated sexual situation I've had has been the guy I lost my virginity to.
But she said it was uncomplicated.
No, that one is complicated.
But then you also said it was uncomplicated.
I think
your generation.
No, that.
Let me tell you something.
That one is complicated.
You
the rest are
You think human beings are disposable. That's the problem with your whole generation. And I'm glad the baby boomers destroyed the planet for you. Because we hate you. We hate your youth and your beauty and your cavalier attitude towards sex. I don't think it's possible for men and women to just be casual lovers.
I think it is, but I don't think sex creates feelings. I think that if there are already feelings there, it's going to enhance them. I don't think that suddenly, like, somebody that, like, I met in a bar, let's say, and we're attracted to each other, we go back and we have sex, I don't think suddenly I'm going to be in love with that person. But, like, the guy I lost my virginity to, I already had feelings for him, so it just enhanced those feelings.
Right. So you can have sex with somebody without being in love with them?
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's not going to be as good as sex with somebody I love.
Mm-hmm.
In my experience.
And do you think men fall in love more easily than women?
No.
I'm told men fall in love more.
Really?
Yes. I'm told men confuse the sexual excitement with love.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So you lost your virginity, Hurricane Sandy. The world was falling apart.
Not necessarily why not. Like me and the guy, he's another comic. I'll say his name, Frank Vignola was who it was. He's another comic.
Oh, I lost my virginity to him too.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. By the way, I'm debuting it on your podcast. Mm-hmm. I've never actually... said, yeah, what, don't go, oh, this is a big deal here, guys.
And you're in love with him.
Yeah, and he's a comic. Anyway.
Is he married?
No. So anyway, he, but we
If he were here tonight, if I brought him up here tonight.
That would be good.
You know, as the host of a podcast, I can marry a couple.
Yeah, but he's not interested. He's not interested.
He's not interested.
No.
How lucky would he be?
I know. But anyway.
What is he? Blind? Insane? Stupid?
Maybe all of those things.
Let's call him right now.
Let's not do it right now. We could do it later.
I'll talk him into it.
No, but he's another comic, but we had already known each other beforehand. So we had started like fooling around and hanging out a little bit before Hurricane Sandy. And then we both were on a show at the Underground Lounge, which is now called some other thing. And we went back to his place afterwards to hang out. And I don't know about you guys, but like we didn't think it was going to be as big a deal as it was. Like when people were like, oh, there's a hurricane coming, we were kind of like, eh, it's not going to be a big deal. So we were, you know, planning to hang out anyway. So we go back to his place, you know, we had sex. And then given everything that happened, we ended up spending like 3 days together just having lots of sex, you know.
Wow.
Yeah, it was good. I mean, it was a good way to lose your virginity. I have no complaints.
You were trapped for 3 days because of Hurricane Sandy.
Yeah.
Do you mind if I ask you how many sexual encounters you had?
Oh my God. I mean, it was a lot. I don't know how. It was a lot. We had sex a lot, definitely. Because, mm-hmm. I mean, what else are you going to. Well, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So FEMA came in.
Yeah, FEMA came in and was like,
this and rescued
can't,
you.
This can't happen. This is not cool. No.
Yeah.
No, then once it got to whatever, I forget, I think it went, what, like Saturday, Sunday, Monday? Was that how it happened, Hurricane Sandy? Does anybody remember? I want to say like Monday or Tuesday was like mm-hmm. when everything was kind of sort of back to normal.
Right.
And once cabs started running again, because this was before Uber was even popular or anything.
Right.
This was back in 2012, guys. We wanted to make sure, he was very concerned he didn't want me to end up in like a gypsy cab or end up like in some cab that was like illegitimate and going off wherever. So we made sure that like things were okay and cabs were up and running again. And then he was like, okay, like, you know, we'll find you a cab and, you know, you can go home and all that. And he was very like, I want to make sure he got home okay. You know, he was very good about everything, so...
Dating.
Yeah.
Men and women in New York City. Does a man put you in a subway? Will he walk you to a subway stop? And is that chivalrous? Because when I was your age, before we had subways, the idea
of... The Underground Railroad.
Yes, the Underground Railroad.
It was cool.
You know, when I was your age in New York City, the idea of having sex with a woman and then, you know, walking her to a subway stop is so degrading in my mind, it makes me hard.
Just to think. I see, yeah.
That would be the ultimate, like,
it's so weird
adios.
Because
does a guy walk you to a subway stop and say goodbye?
It depends.
Or does he put you in an Uber?
So the guy, let's go back, let's backtrack. I've had both. I've had guys I've had one night stands with be like, you know, and then I've just left, you know what I mean, and it's no big deal. Or I've had, you know, like the guy I lost my virginity to, every time I took a cab, he would walk me down, you know, to the cab.
To the cab?
Yeah.
Did he pay for the cab?
Sometimes he'd pay, sometimes I'd pay. It was sometimes, depending on, he's a comic too, so depending on who had money.
Right, okay. When you go out.
Yeah.
With a man, is it implicit that the man is going to pay?
I don't think it's implicit. I think,
is there something awkward when the bill comes? Does the date have to go a certain way for the man to pick up the check?
See, I don't think so. I actually had an awkward date where he said beforehand, he was like, how do you want to do this? And he mentioned, he was like, you know, so there's no expectations, which already I found weird because just because you pay doesn't mean there's... I don't feel... You could pay and then we could just make out and then both of us go home and then maybe see each other again. Like,
how significant is making out?
I think it's very significant. I mean, I've been told I'm a good kisser because I lost my virginity at 25. That was all I ever did for a long time. So I got good at it.
You could be the mayor of Astoria.
I could be.
You go out with a guy. There's sexual tension. Is there tension as to who is going to pick up the tab? Is that part of the dynamic?
I think it's one of those things that just kind of happens naturally.
Do you feel the shiver, the cold? People listening at home, you'll notice there's a chill that's gone down everybody's back. It's because Pat Dixon has entered the room.
You missed that by like 5 minutes. Like,
is Pat here?
Yeah.
Okay.
He's been here.
Money, sex.
So I feel, I'll always offer. I don't really feel like that makes or breaks the situation, like who pays or, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't really get too big into all that stuff. I feel like it's like how a person treats you.
Do you feel insulted if the guy pays?
No, I don't feel insulted. No.
Would you prefer if the man pays?
I think it depends.
Suppose the man is in his 50s.
Right.
And he's taking you out.
It'd be nice.
Suppose you're with a man in his 50s. You're having sex. He asks you to help him with the penis pump. Is that a turnoff?
I might be intrigued by that, actually.
All right, let's plug some gigs. Where are you going to be?
Third Wednesday of every month.
Yes.
Here at QED Astoria at 9 p.m. is the My First Time show. You should all come check it out. I book comics and storytellers. They all talk about losing their virginity. It's good. Going to be at Broadway Comedy Club next week. I'm there a lot.
Okay. You know, there's a storm coming tonight. You may want to slip into something more comfortable.
Want
to get home.
I should get out of here.
Angela Cobb,
Thank you so much. Thank you.
One more time for Angela Cobb. Well. This is so great. This turned out to be fantastic. I'm going to bring up the most despised human being on my podcast. I love having him on the show, despite the number of subscribers who continue to stop listening because they hate him so much. He is undefeated in the roast battles here in New York City. I think he's 6-0, the number?
Yeah.
He hosts the New York City Crime Report, which is one of the funniest podcasts out there. Please welcome my friend, Pat Dixon. Hey, good to see you, buddy.
Thanks.
How are you, sir?
I'm great. I'm happy to be superlative in any way, Dave.
The most despised guest I've ever had on this show.
I mean, that's an honor. And it's funny because I always try my hardest to be likable when I come to see you. And I guess some people just don't have it. How are you?
I'm okay. I spent a lot of time in the woods, so I'm unshaven, and I look like a criminal. I look like I could be a subject of one of your reports.
You do, actually. Yeah, you look very similar to what you look like is not like just your typical criminal. You look like some sort of a guy who was on so much Oxycontin and ran out that he had to shoot a pharmacist.
Well, you can't. This is a podcast. It's audio, but I'm wearing a ski cap.
Let's just say you look like shit. Okay. Let's just say, call a spade a spade. It's the unshavenness, really, in the ski cap. You're right.
Yeah.
Kind of. Why the ski cap? Did you have another surgery or something? Sometimes you have to take that day, you know, where you just don't.
You just
do
give
that.
Up.
And best to do that when you do a live podcast in front of real people.
I love having you on this show.
My pleasure. I love being on your show.
As long as we don't talk about politics, right?
It's funny, but you're right. You know, I seem to agree with you on so many things that you say. You're the most misogynist feminist I've ever met.
I'm a liberal, so I can just say horribly racist and anti-feminist things, and people say, it's okay.
Oh, yeah, not only that, you're a Jew, so you get a whole... You get to play that J card. You didn't convert to that just for that, did you?
You know, I have a theory about Hollywood liberals, and then we'll go on.
Boy, I do too.
Hollywood liberals are the personification of hypocrisy. They're anti-union, talk a big game, but then when they have to actually do something decent, they are incapable of it. I am convinced that Hollywood liberals are hateful misanthropes who use the Democratic Party to indemnify the horror show that is their existence.
Wow, that is a mouthful. I was going to say they're dicks.
That's a mouthful.
Yeah. You make a good point, you know, all in all, and they may be anti-union, you know, but they've all joined SAG, you know, like say a guy like me, like if I go shoot something, which I did recently down in Brooklyn, when you go to shoot something, you have to join SAG, you know, and I don't get any benefits for that, you know, they don't provide benefits unless you make X amount of dollars shooting stuff every year, and, you know, I'm not ashamed to say I don't shoot $30,000 worth of show business crap every year, so they suck up the benefits, you know, so basically I contribute money so that Matthew Perry can go to rehab or something.
What's happened is people resent the unions because they don't have a union. It's not the union's fault that there aren't enough unions. We need unions. Unions have to be brought back. Only 8% of the economy is unionized.
Yeah, I mean,
to be
like
up to 25%.
If we could break up Hollywood the same way the unions broke up Detroit, you know, then we'd be probably a more entertained nation, right?
Are you anti-union?
Well, I'm anti an unskilled worker getting $60 an hour to turn a screw.
Why?
You know, but because it makes cars too expensive, and then they can't be bought, and
no.
then and the next thing you know, your competitors are outdoing you, and then factories are moving overseas.
That's not why. It's not labor costs and health care benefits have nothing to do with the
cost of a car.
That's a myth propagated by CEOs who want to cut costs and jack up the stock price so they can cash out their stock options and collect their money in the Cayman Islands. You know that.
Well, I do now. No, I'm not the kind of person who sticks to the party line if there's you know, a legitimate argument against it. I never believe anything somebody just says to me, regardless of the, you know, the... I mean, let's face it. I mean, I would never doubt the veracity of your information, you know, as a source. But, yeah, everything's bullshit until you Google it, right? So,
Raising the minimum wage to $15. You know that the Congressional Budget Office has shown that it would be a wash when it comes to inflation.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, hey, I'm not talking about the minimum wage. I was talking about Detroit. But, like, I think $15 an hour may be a good minimum wage. I don't know. I think that also maybe we should do away with this lifetime health care that Congress has.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And good stuff, too. Dental and everything, you know.
Yeah.
Like, why are we paying taxes for those people to go to the doctor? You know, if we didn't have to pay for all that shit, maybe coming up with health care alternatives in this country would be easier, you know.
Right.
And, like, the government does suck.
We've just celebrated 100 days of... Trump.
Yeah, boy, what a celebration. Oh, it's so nice to love a president who the media loves, you know what I mean? I love the positive coverage that he gets, and I just, like, I hate to be always cheering for a winner, you know, but...
You voted for Trump, right?
Yeah. Of course I did.
Just
do you think I would vote for Hillary Clinton? How come I'm not ahead by 50 points, you might ask? I have hot sauce in my purse. You know, I mean, like, she can say the most, like, tone-deaf racist things and get away with it, you know? And I think that, yeah, I am surprised that Trump got picked apart.
Well, black people,
as heartily as he did.
African-Americans like hot sauce. She was being interviewed in front on a morning show with African-Americans.
Let's note that you just said African-Americans like hot sauce.
That's a fact.
Is it a fact?
Yes.
Do they like watermelon, too? How about chicken?
She was being interviewed... She was being interviewed, and they asked her if she liked her food.
This is how he handles a point that he doesn't want to deal with, by the way.
They asked her if she likes hot food, and she says, I have hot sauce in my purse.
Produce the hot sauce.
And were the black people offended who were interviewing her? No.
Well, I'm sure that they didn't interview the ones that were going to say something. You know how that goes. It's selective interviewing, of course. You know, right. I mean, I've heard from black people who thought that was fucking ridiculous. Sure.
Okay. Let's do the New York City Crime Report.
Okay, you want to do that?
Yes.
All right. Well, I'm actually launching a new podcast, actually, in the very near future. And because I'm, you know, covering New York City crime is fun. I'm going to keep doing it, no question. You know, I mean, like, there's so much humor to be had in it.
Mm-hmm.
And I might have mentioned this on your show before, but I remember once they caught a child molester in Queens who was Asian, and I thought, that's an interesting thing, you know, because, like, it shows you can do anything in this country. Really, you know, and that's not expected behavior, you know. I mean, it's not an Asian stereotype, you know. And really, I thought, how come there's not more Asian child molesters? You never see them, and I think it might be because their candy tastes like shrimp. So hard to get a kid in the van, you know, when you have prawn candy. It's a shrimp on the bag that gets like, I'm not interested in that, you know. I think you'd have better luck offering dick at that point, actually. You know? It's like, hey, I want some dick.
What would you be more upset about an Asian child molester? The fact that he's molesting your kid, or he's in a van being driven by an Asian?
Right. That's the real danger, is the accident they're going to have on the way back to his hideout.
I apologize. I hate to try. We have to wrap it up?
Yeah.
What? He just got here. All right.
I'm sorry. I have to apologize for being so late here.
What happened?
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, as you know, I've been married now for a year and a half, be 2 years in November. And, you know, so this is a rare thing, but I met a girl that I really hit it off with on the way. And I thought, I better take advantage of this. My wife's out of town. And No, it's not.
You
that.
Really did vote for Trump.
No, I'm not a... The last thing I would do is commit adultery. I dropped my phone down into the subway bed.
That happened to me.
Yeah,
and I was
going to immediately go down and grab it, you know. There was an MTA guy there, and he wouldn't let me go down. He saved my life, maybe, but he also saved me from being on time.
That happened to me. My phone literally fell through that thing. It smelled like a pizza, so this rat brought it back up to me. I got very lucky. Let's do one crime report, and then I'm sorry we have to wrap it up. So let's do one crime report.
Oh, I mean, I was gonna. I'll tell one more, like sort of a very brief thing, since we're almost out of time. And the crime report is it's at crimereport.nyc. I love being a new. His listeners always love it because it's so much funnier. They took that hard. They take everything hard.
Well,
thank you for your laughter.
I introduced you as the heel.
As the heel, right?
Which you're
I
the
thought,
heel.
And I try to wear the black hat. But, you know, it hurts. You know, the silence hurts. But I will say just this. A woman was abducted. Don't ever feel like you're safe, even though crime is, like, you know, way down and everything. They call it, there was a guy who abducted a woman in front of Port Authority bus terminal. Just snatched her up and pimped her out. He pimped her out. He forced her to turn tricks as they drove all the way to New Mexico. And
A Port Authority?
No. She was at the Port Authority. The Port Authority police did not abduct her. She was abducted by an abductor.
Oh.
Who was a captor and a pimp then. And a sex trafficker, I guess. And so, like, she made it back. It was amazing. And she noted in the story, because there was the question, how bad was this, you know, experience? And she said it was pretty bad, but on the whole, still better than Greyhound. Did I say?
New York City Crime Report.
Yes, New York City Crime Report.
And how do people follow you on Twitter?
They can follow me there at Pat Dixon, and I'm verified, so it's the real me.
Pat Dixon. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. We're going to do more of these, and I want to thank everybody from QED, QEDAstoria.com. If you're visiting New York City, get on the N train, stop at Ditmar, get off, and come to QED. It's the greatest comedy club in New York City. Thank you, everybody. That's our show. Thank you so much for listening. If you enjoyed this live episode of The David Feldman Show, give us a good review on iTunes. Share it with your friends. Please copy and paste the link to this show and send it to all your friends. Tell them about this amazing show. Please do all your Amazon shopping via The David Feldman Show website. Just click on the Amazon banner and shop away. We get a small percentage of everything you purchase. It does not cost you more to shop through The David Feldman Show website. In fact, you're taking money out of Amazon's pocket. We have a YouTube channel. Not too many people listen to audio on YouTube, but if you want to listen to The David Feldman Show on YouTube, just go to YouTube, type in David Feldman Comedy, and my YouTube channel comes up. Please subscribe. And YouTube is a great way to share this show. It's a great way to copy and paste the YouTube link into Facebook, Twitter, or an email. Please do me a favor. Share the comedy, share the knowledge, share the love, share the David Feldman Show. For $5 a month, you can become a subscriber and gain access to all our premium content. We take all major credit cards. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the Go Premium button, and sign up. And if you already are a monthly subscriber and you don't have the password, hit the contact button over davidfeldmanshow.com and we'll remind you what the password is. Also, if you're a listener, hit the contact button and tell me what you think of the show and offer up some suggestions. Make sure to go to qedastoria.com and check out the calendar and see which comics are coming to that wonderful comedy room in Astoria, Queens. Thanks to Cambry, Christian Finnegan, and Chris Gersbeck over at QED. Our executive producer is Alex Brazell from the Showbriz Studios in downtown. Oh, I forgot. I am going to be at the Philadelphia Punchline Sunday at 7 o'clock with Dr. Katz, Dr. Jonathan Katz, and Bonnie McFarlane. and we're doing a live episode of Dr. Katz at the Philadelphia Punchline to raise money for Artwell, healing people through art, theartwell.org, Philadelphia Punchline, this Sunday, 7 o'clock, Dr. Katz Live, me, Bonnie McFarlane, and a whole bunch of other people. What a great show for a great cause. From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, Medicare for All.
You're listening to the David Feldman radio program, You Sad Pathetic Hump.